Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha and today's topic is treatment of black triangles. In the previous video, we discussed the introduction, problems associated with this problem and the classification of the papilla or the loss of interdental papilla. So in today's video, we will proceed with the treatment aspects. But before proceeding with the treatment aspect, let us discuss one important consideration, that is Tarnow's 5mm rule. So basically what Tarnow did in the year 1992, an observational study on humans wherein he tried to correlate the presence of interdental papilla, just the presence, nothing to do with the amount of the papillary film. He just correlated whether the papilla is present or absent with the distance, the vertical distance between the bone crest and contact point. So, somewhere, if this is the bone crest, clear? Somewhere here, and this is the contact point. If this distance was found to be less than or equal to 5 mm, then the papillary fill or papilla present was 100% of the time. This is Tarnow's 5 mm rule. If the distance between crest of the alveolar bone and the contact point is less than or equal to 5 mm, the papilla was present for almost 100% of the time. Maybe 98%, but it was almost present there. Nothing to do with the percentage of fill. It is merely presence or absence. Okay. So, for the papilla to be present completely, the distance between the crest of the alveolar bone and contact point should be less than or equal to 5 mm. This factor has to be kept in mind while deciding whether to go for papillary reconstruction or not. So the pre-diagnosis should be the diagnostic thing that to be done before deciding upon a surgical technique for papillary reconstruction is to measure this distance in the case per se. If the distance is favorable, only then we should attempt papillary reconstruction. Otherwise, also, if we attempt to, we will not get 100% fill, because in the same study, when this distance was 6 mm and above, the papilla was not present always. It was present in few cases and the present papilla was not complete fill. It was partial fill. So, even if the papilla was present, when the distance was 6 mm and above, it was partial present. Okay. That is why while deciding for papilla reconstruction, we should have this measurement in our case and only then proceed with papilla reconstruction. And even if we are keen upon, or even if the patient is asking for this procedure, we should discuss the consequences, the outcomes of this treatment plan. Clear? Like in terms of the fill, the percentage fill of the papilla if attempted. If the distance is favorable, we can assure the patient for 100% fill. But if the distance is unfavorable, then we should discuss with the patient before starting the treatment, because it is basically aesthetic procedure. So, taking up such a treatment in a patient is a really difficult task, because it is difficult to assess the patient's aesthetic requirements, patient's expectations. That is why aesthetics is something we should not mess up with, and we should always go by the patient's choice. So if the patient still wants this treatment, please discuss with the patient beforehand that there is not going to be a complete fill of the papilla. There will be certain deficit. The papilla reconstruction will result into partial rebuild or the reconstruction of papilla and not a complete one, because of this important factor, this important consideration. This is Tarnow's 5 mm rule. So now that we are clear with the classification and this rule, now we will discuss the treatment aspect. Now under treatment aspect, as briefly discussed in the previous video, we have non-surgical options and surgical options. Under non-surgical, we have options from all the disciplines of dentistry. First, of course, because it is a periodontal problem, the first option is non-surgical periodontal therapy. That is scaling, root planing, curettage, sometimes repeated curettage, which will result into tissue formation and maybe papular reconstruction as a result. Not every time, but yes, this is one of the option. Second is endoconservative, that is by cosmetics or composite buildup, because if understood on this case, if the papilla is lost, that is maybe let's say the papilla is somewhere here and this is the blood triangle, then either we can attempt to fill this triangle from this end or from this end, that is by soft tissue augmentation or shifting the contact point slightly apically as much as possible. I don't say completely, but as much as possible within the case limits. So when we cannot attempt to shift the soft tissue, that is papilla coronally, we may go for shifting the contact point slightly apically. Again, in conjunction, in coordination, it should be matching to the adjacent teeth and everything. Okay, the entire aesthetics should give overall pleasant outlook, and that is why we have an option of endoconservative treatments. The third option is prosthetic, that is recontouring or relocating the contact point once again, but from prosthetic perspective. Fourth is orthodontic, by orthodontic tooth movement. If the alignments are corrected, maybe the papilla will then reconstruct in the newly developed or newly provided outlines. If the teeth are malpositioned, or let's say there is a diastema, the papilla doesn't get adequate hard tissue support, that is in terms of the walls of the tooth and the appropriate contact point where it should end. Clear? So if the orthodontic tooth movement is completed, the papilla may build up as a result. And one more treatment is, it's not a treatment, prophylactic, because it is seen that one of the reasons for loss of interdental papilla is incorrect or improper oral hygiene measures. So in such cases, due to trauma, what we should do is first to terminate those incorrect hygiene procedures, to stop them immediately, give those tissues some resting time because they were disturbed, they were traumatized till now. And then after a period of 10 days or 2 weeks maybe, we can reinstate the new set of regimen, new set of oral hygiene regimen which are favorable to the tissue growth and maintenance. Clear? These are the various non-surgical options. I repeat, non-surgical periodontal therapy, endodontic conservative approach, prosthetic approach, orthodontic approach, and oral hygiene measures should be rectified. Incorrect oral hygiene measures, if any, should be rectified. So with this, non-surgical options, we are done with non-surgical options. Now we will focus on to the main content of today's topic, the surgical options. See, every treatment plan, we have prophylactic measures, preventive measures, and the treatment plan. So same goes for this papilla reconstruction, or mainly the loss of interdental papilla. So for prevention of loss of interdental papilla, what we can do is we can adopt the papilla preservation techniques. Whenever we perform any surgical techniques for periodontal disease, we may opt for papilla preservation techniques wherever possible. For this, you may refer to my video, papilla preservation flap, when we were discussing periodontal flap surgery topic. And as far as other modifications of papilla preservation flap technique are concerned, which generally falls under the category minimally invasive surgical techniques, We will discuss those techniques, simplified papilla preservation flap technique, modified papilla preservation flap technique, and modification of its modification. We will discuss all these modified or minimally invasive surgical techniques in upcoming videos once we are done with this topic, as requested by one of the viewers. So in prevention, what we can do is we can adopt papilla preservation approach. Clear? So that there is no or minimum loss of interdental papilla. Now even after this, or for any reason, if now that the interdental papilla is lost, what we can do is the treatment, and the treatment is surgical papilla reconstruction. So under papilla reconstruction, mainly we have three techniques. The first one was given by Beagle in the year 1992, the next by Han and Takei 1996, and the third one by Azzi et al 1999. Beagle gave the pedicle graft technique, Han and Takei gave semilunar coronary reposition flap technique, which is resembling to the semilunar flap technique discussed for root coverage technique. If you have watched my video, semilunar flap technique for root coverage, which was discussed in the advanced flaps, coronary reposition flap and semilunar flap, then this technique will be easy to understand. And Azzi et al. Gave the technique envelope type flap technique, which resembles to the envelope technique for root coverage, and the envelope flap preparation, that is a flap preparation which consists of only horizontal incisions and no vertical incisions. So with this, now we will begin to discuss in each technique individually in detail. So the first technique, Beagle. See, all the three techniques have three main steps: incisions, graft positioning or flap repositioning, whichever as per the technique proposed by them, and suturing. Three steps: incisions, graft positioning or flap repositioning, and suturing. So what Beagle in the year 1992 gave is pedicle graft technique. In this technique, what they did, if we understand from the proximal aspect, clear? So the first step is incision onto the palatal aspect. Please listen very carefully. Partial thickness flap preparation onto the palatal aspect. This partial thickness flap preparation goes through the entire interproximal site, and please, it does not pierce or comes out from the facial aspect. It starts from the palatal aspect, the interproximal site onto the palatal aspect, the partial thickness flap preparation, and then this flap is elevated. How the flap elevates? So let's say this is the outline. This is how the flap is elevated. This kind of flap elevation happens, and here is the remaining exposed partial thickness flap preparation. This dark outline, this corresponds to the periosteum and connective tissue bed, which is exposed due to this partial thickness flap elevation. Clear? So with this partial thickness flap preparation, now the second step is this flap elevation. So here that step is flap repositioning. We are not using any graft here as per this technique by Beagle 1992. First step, partial thickness flap preparation from the palatal aspect, and flap elevation. The final step is the flap is folded. okay, this folded flap is suture and this entire thing is kept open to heal by secondary indention. Is the technique getting clear or easy for you to understand? This partial thickness flap, which is elevated from the palatal aspect, is folded onto its facial aspect, and the exposed periosteum connective tissue bed is exposed for healing by secondary indention. One more thing can be done here is to place a periodontal dressing so that it covers this exposed area and additionally provide support to this newly created papilla, which is a folded tissue, folded flap tissue from the palatal aspect. See, from the facial aspect, this folded tissue must be getting support from the laterally, the tooth borders, the tooth outlines must be providing support to this newly created folded papillary flap tissue. But from the palatal aspect, a periodontal dressing, if placed, may provide additional support. And also that periodontal dressing may cover this exposed periosteum connective tissue bed. Of course, followed by it, the periodontal dressing shouldn't be placed directly up tin foil, sterile aluminium tin foil, followed by periodontal dressing, to get these two advantages, covering the wound and getting additional support for the newly created papilla. This is how Beagle in the year 1992 gave pedicle graft technique. The major advantage of this technique is the nature, pedicle, the nature of this so-called graft. It is pedicle. That means the blood supply is very much intact, because you understand this interdental tissue is a very tiny space comparatively. So splitting open the flaps and putting some connective tissue graft or some detached graft, which is detached from its parent origin and brought here and stuffed inside, vascularity is the main concern, and that is why this technique gives a major advantage over any other technique in terms of its vascularity, because it is very much pedicled, it is very much attached to its parent origin, it is not detached from it at all, or it is not something which is detached from some site and brought in here and stuffed inside, which is going to be the case with the other technique. But with this technique, the major advantage is its pedicled nature, which gives advantages, benefits in terms of vascularity. So with this technique is complete. A quick summary: split thickness flap preparation from the palatal aspect, and the elevated split thickness flap is folded and sutured there. This suture is within the fold itself and not to any other tissues of the oral cavity, any other adjacent tissue. It is not disturbing any adjacent tissues. The fold is within itself only. It is paper which is just folded and sutured back. It is not taking support for suturing also from any other tissues. Clear? This completes the technique Beagle 1992 pedicle graft technique. With this, we will move on to the next technique, Han and Takai, that is semilunar coronally repositioned flap technique. Han and Takai, 1996, semilunar coronally repositioned flap. So if you have watched my video on advanced flaps, which has discussed coronally positioned flap and semilunar flap technique, it is easy to understand this technique. So again, first we will discuss this technique from the facial aspect, and then I will show you what is its status on the proximal aspect. So on to the facial aspect, let's say if this is the interdental papilla and this is the mucogingival junction, the first step, incision. Now the name itself says semilunar coronally reposition. So of course the incision is a semilunar incision into the alveolar mucosa. You see, there is hardly any space in this attached gingiva, keratinized gingiva, after which where we can do coronally reposition. Just try to compare this distance and this distance. So of course, as discussed during advanced flaps for root coverage, the distance should be add-on to, so that the final flap rests onto the bone crest, and that is why here also the semilunar incision will be given into the alveolar mucosa. So somewhere here, in that technique also, the semilunar incision was connected by the sulcular incision. Here also we will give intrasulcular incision onto the mesial half and the distal half of the two adjacent teeth, which forms this embrasure or the loss of interdental papilla tissue. So all these incisions are now connected. This partial thickness flap from above and this partial thickness preparation from below. So this is how this entire pouch is detached from the root surface. Please note, the flap is not dissected. This is entirely partial thickness flap preparation. The flap is not dissected, unlike the case with Beagle technique, wherein the split thickness flap was dissected and there was sharp dissection. Here there is nothing like that. It is totally a pouch creation. This entire mucogingival, this entire complex, papillary complex, is going to be now positioned coronally. With all these incisions connected to each other, now this entire complex is shifted coronally, so that this current margin will now fall into the embrasure. So with this, the final position looks like here. This semilunar incision is, this entire pouch is shifted coronally, so now the papilla should look like this, and with this mucogingival junction, this semilunar flap somewhere reaches here, and this portion is now exposed, the underlying periosteum and connective tissue. This is the final repositioning done. Still the technique is not over. We are on to the second step, the flap repositioning plus this pouch. How do you expect this pouch to stay there without any suturing elsewhere or any other support, because every tissue has a tendency to go back to its original position, including mucogingival junction. So how do you expect this entire papillary complex to stay there as it is, just with a single partial thickness flap preparation? No, it's highly impossible, because over the period of time, if left like this with a simple partial thickness flap preparation and coronally positioning, as in case with the semilunar flap, this position may not stay here. In semilunar flap, what we had done for root coverage, we coronally positioned the semilunar flap preparation followed by a periodontal dressing, especially sinoacrylates. Okay, we didn't use suturing, but we did use dressings or something of that kind, so that the flap preparation stays in that place until the primary healing or the initial healing is taken place. But here, this is an entire complex which is a pouch like preparation. This is an opening from where we can stuff inside some amount of graft, so that coronally this papillary tissue gets some support. See, you can appreciate laterally it has got support from the walls of these teeth, but and of course palatally it has a support because we haven't manipulated anything from the palatal aspect, but coronally this margin may tend to shift apically from to its original position. So to avoid that, to prevent this margin to go back to its original position, we stuff in the connective tissue graft harvested most commonly from palate or from other regions such as maxillary tuberosity. So yes, in the second step, after coronally repositioning this entire complex, we insert connective tissue graft here and then suture it here. This is how the Hen and Takai 1996 semilunar coronally reposition flap technique is performed. laterally or sorry proximally if we try to appreciate, the technique looks somewhat if here is the incision given. This incision, of course, proximally to show the insertion of the connective tissue, it looks like it has detached, but from the facial aspect, I hope it is really very clear that it is not detached. It is an entirely a pouch preparation wherein the connective tissue graft is stuffed inside. So proximally, if we try to appreciate this one semilunar incision, let's say at this position, and this flap looks detached, but it is not. It is coronally repositioned. It is connected somewhere by these regions which are not incised. Okay, these regions which have connectivity of this entire papillary complex to the entire oral cavity tissue region. Okay, so proximally if we try to appreciate this semilunar incision, if brought coronally and the connective tissue graft is inserted here, the connective tissue graft is inserted here and then sutured here. Clear? This is how Han and Takai's semilunar coronally reposition flap technique with connective tissue graft is performed. I hope this technique is clear to you all. Now with this, we will discuss the third and the final technique, Azzi et al. Actually, Azzi et al. 1999, he has proposed multiple techniques. But the common principle of all his techniques is envelope flap technique. So what Azzi et al. 1999 proposed was envelope type technique. So this technique resembles the envelope flap technique of root coverage and the envelope flap preparation. That is a flap preparation which does not involve any vertical incisions. So let's say first of all understand it on the facial aspect. So let's say if this is the papillary tissue, then again the incisions are given intrasulcular, clear, and once the intrasulcular incisions are completed, a horizontal incision connecting the two onto the facial aspect of the interproximal region is given. So that this interproximal tissue is detached, and here on the facial aspect, a partial thickness flap preparation and elevation beyond the mucogingival junction is done. So let's say a pouch is created involving two teeth. So this has it is an amalgamation of the principles of envelope technique, that is two envelopes, and the alternate papillar technique or pouch and tunnel technique. We cannot say pouch and tunnel technique here because it's not a tunnel, we are splitting the papilla. So we can tell it has taken a partial influence from alternate papillar technique, where we were dissecting one papilla and preserving one papilla for tunnel. So the portion where we dissected the papilla is taken here. So the principles of envelope flap technique and the envelope flap preparation, because we are not giving any vertical incisions. Remember, here also we are going to coronally reposition it after inserting the connective tissue graft. So once these incisions are completed, that is the intrasulcular incisions which are connected by a horizontal incisions onto the facial aspect of the interdental papilla, existing interdental papilla, then this flap is elevated, split thickness flap elevated apically beyond the mucogingival junction. Of course, the reason behind elevating the flap beyond mucogingival junction is to get the looseness so that it can be coronally repositioned. So after these incisions are completed, then at this incision point, this interproximal flap is elevated, and here entirely connective tissue graft is inserted and sutured at this point. So the final look is somewhat like this. Here at this point there will be sutures, and the connective tissue graft is positioned somewhat to this manner so that the interproximal papilla is created. Onto the proximal aspect, if we try to understand, so if this incision, this horizontal incision corresponds to this level, then this flap is also elevated, and this partial thickness flap is also elevated here. Okay, and here is the connective tissue graft that is inserted, and this flaps are, this can be coronally positioned and sutured. This is how the envelope flap technique by Azzi et al. 1999 works. So this completes the third technique, Azzi et al. 1999, envelope flap technique. A quick summary: Beagle in the year 1992 gave pedicle graft technique, wherein we gave partial thickness incision from the palatal aspect. This is the major point in Beagle's technique. Split thickness flap preparation from the palatal aspect, and that split thickness flap is folded within itself to form a interdental papilla. Clear? The second technique, Han and Takai, semilunar reposition flap, semilunar coronally reposition flap. Here the incisions are given onto the facial aspect. Semilunar incision in the alveolar mucosa. This is an important point. The semilunar incision is given in the alveolar mucosa, which are connected to the two intracircular incisions in the mesial and distal half. The second important point, the mesial half and distal half, not the entire sulcus, just the mesial and distal half of the two adjacent teeth, which forms that embrasure or the missing papillary region. And then the entire pouch is coronally repositioned, in which we stuff the connective tissue graft, or we insert a connective tissue graft and suture it back. And the third technique is where we split open the flap preparation. In Han and Takai's semilunar coronally reposition flap, we did not split open the flap preparation. We kept it as entire pouch, wherein we inserted the connective tissue graft. But here, the entire split thickness flap preparation, including the apical flap dissection, sharp dissection apically beyond mucogingival junction, and split opening this flaps by the horizontal incision onto the facial aspect of the interproximal region, and inserting connective tissue graft, suturing it, which involves light coronally repositioning to cover the connective tissue graft. So this is how we can achieve reconstruction of the lost interdental papilla as appreciated. If you appreciate the position here and here, of course this position looks very much below the interproximal CEJ. Clear? So this is how we attempt to reconstruct the lost interdental papilla. But of course, after doing a thorough diagnosis and getting in touch with the etiology of this interdental papilla loss, only after identifying the etiology and diagnosing the case thoroughly, only then we should attempt the papilla reconstruction. Clear? Otherwise, the patient must first complete all the other treatments required from the other disciplines or the departments of dentistry. Complete the initial periodontal therapy, that is non-surgical periodontal therapy, and once the entire inflammation is cleared and the tissues are healthy enough to undergo a surgery, only then the surgery should be attempted. So with this, we complete the treatment aspect of the black triangles, that is the loss of interdental papilla. The techniques, that is papilla reconstruction technique, three main techniques: Beagle 1992, pedicle graft technique, Han and Takai 1996, semilunar coronally reposition flap technique with connective tissue graft, and Azzi et al. 1999, envelope type flap technique with connective tissue graft. So I hope this topic is clear to you all, and I hope, really, really hope that this chapter is clear to you all. It's getting easy for all of you to understand. But if you still have any doubts or any queries, or you find any difficulties, feel free to ask me in the comment section below or mail it to my email ID dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com, or you can ask me on my Facebook Messenger, Instagram, and I will reply to all your queries. And please be assured, I will discuss all the requested topics once this topic is completed. I hope you find this helpful. Until then, study well, take care, stay safe.